God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May of 1985, then President of Germany, Richard von Weizsäcker, offered a speech during a ceremony commemorating the 40th anniversary of the end of World War II. In his remarks, von Weizsäcker paid homage to the Jewish adage that insists, "Seeking to forget makes exile all the longer. The secret of redemption lies in remembrance." Jewish practices of remembrance of the Shoah reveal what von Weizsäcker saw as transformative hope, bearing witness to redemption in human history as God reconciled what has been divided. Today, we are not talking about Germany's complicated history, nor extolling practices of remembrance that emerged in the difficult decades following that awful war. Though many indeed have witnessed faithfully to God's redemption of pain and suffering tied to that particular past. On this day, however, we gather in this place, seeking solace in music, in prayer, and in silence, as we lead into a different sort of invitation. Here, we are invited to discover a love that holds us as we encounter death and life, and life and death. God's reconciling love is redeeming the world. This good news we have come to know in Christ comforts us through difficult experiences, deepening our trust and awakening our hope in God's redeeming work throughout all time. This mystery sheds light on the truth of our lives, especially as we remember our departed loved ones. Whatever our personal and familial histories, love's power changes our lives. The texts that we heard read this morning witness to the hope of our redemption on this day of remembrance of all the faithful departed. For God looks upon all God has made, remembering each and every creature, all of us, with a love that does not deny our whole story, but rather chooses to redeem our offenses and to transform our pain. Today, we take comfort in the truth that God remembers with mercy and love all who have died, just as God also remembers each of us, numbering not our sins, but reckoning us righteous through the saving love of Jesus Christ. This inconceivable grace is available to all of us, especially amid the sorrow and pain we feel as we live in the absence of those dearly departed who have gone ahead of us to eternity. Human remembrance, however graceful, can leave us wanting. Regret and grief are often intermingled with the gratitude and love in our hearts. And yet, remembrance can be that tender place where we discover God's love with us, surrounding us. C.S. Lewis, the great Anglican author, reflects on this in his book entitled A Grief Observed, a book that he wrote after the death of his wife, Helen Joy. In that book, he muses, as we all do, about whether the dead can see us as we continue living here on earth. And he writes honestly in that book about his ache for her actual physical presence. Lewis writes, in one part of the book, as if speaking to Joy herself, he says, "We didn't idolize each other. We tried to keep no secrets. You knew the rotten places in me already. If you now see anything worse, I can take it. So can you. Rebuke, explain, mock, forgive. For this is one of the miracles of love. It gives power of seeing through its own enchantments and yet not being disenchanted. To see in although he sees. Lewis's words have been sticking with me this week. However we choose to commune with dear ones who have died, this invitation to recognize how love has changed us can strengthen us for continuing on this path of life as we embrace the whole truth and the fullness of our connection with those we have loved who have gone home to eternal rest. Our hope in the promise of that future reunion was a hope we heard bearing witness in the text from 1 Thessalonians today, that provocative image of us all being caught up in the air when Jesus returns to bring the fullness of all time, the recreation of heaven and earth, and the reunion of us with those we have loved and lost. Yes, that is one of those promises that we hold on to in our faith, that one day we will again be reunited in the mirror presence of God. We will get to embrace those dearly departed when all is redeemed in the light of love. Acknowledging these contours of sorrow and joy that shape our memories and color our remembrance of these tender bonds that hold us close in life can help us rediscover that even now we are held in loving remembrance by our Creator, whose grace unites the living with the dead in ways we cannot fathom. Like many, I don't often remember my dreams, but this week I did recall a dream I had about my grandmother. She passed away more than a decade ago. It was early morning this week. I woke up in tears mid-sentence. She had fallen. I was crying out to her, and I knew it was in those precious moments, just as she was about to die. This unsolicited remembrance revealed an unexpected invitation in my life to turn toward that love that connects us even beyond the grave. It doesn't remove any of that honest frustration I used to feel about our patterns of relating to one another, or the sadness that still touches my memories of her as I think about her life and her sorrows and her joys. Maybe the dream shouldn't have surprised me. I had watched that film Coco earlier in the week. Some of you have seen it, I can tell. It's an animated film from Pixar that I commend if you haven't yet had a chance to view it. The story of a little boy, Miguel, who undertakes a journey of discovering, clarifying family connections in his family tree. It's this glorious descent among the dead that's imaginative and vivid and provocative and powerful. Miguel ends up awakening to his own unknown regard for these family traditions of remembrance, honoring those ancestors who had gone before, not just in the way they conducted their daily life as the Rivera family, but in those annual remembrances that they would lovingly tend to on the day of the dead. Watching the movie clearly stirred up my unconscious, where many questions about family and belonging lie hidden. And seeing your mementos and photographs today on the table of remembrance at the back of the church by the font, and these paper banners that remind us that Dia de los Muertos invites us to think about all the ways we still are connected in the communion of saints, I'm grateful for these communal habits that we have remembering and the comfort that such remembrance can provide us as we physically bring back together missing pieces of our lives and loves, important pieces that have shaped us to be people who risk loving deeply, like God does. Our Christian faith helps us remember rightly with gratitude and love. Remember that God never ceases to hold dear all those whom we have loved, who have died, just as God never forgets us. In the love of God, we are held fast, not only today, but in the fullness of all time and in all place, where all the dear ones whom we carry in our hearts, whether they live on the other side of the country reside a continent the world over or already have entered eternal rest. God's love redeems our pain, our suffering, our losses, drawing us together and reconnecting us through love, week by week. Jesus remembers us, bringing us back together here at this Eucharistic table so that we can all see our cherished place in the family picture at the sacred table of remembrance that indeed is God's home. Here, we commune in a sacred meal with the Lord of love who serves as our generous host and our pan de cielo, our bread of heaven, as we say in the Spanish language. Jesus' love bears all to remember us, saving us from the power of sin and death, transforming our experiences through his life willingly laid down, and reconciling us through the grace that transforms and heals everything that we know in this life and in the next. Today, as we honor dear ones whom we love and see no longer, let us also draw comfort in redemption's secret revealed through Christ's own precious offering, a meal of sacrificial love that remembers every one of us within God's wider family, now and for all time. Amen.